Welcome, St. John's family, friends, members, and guests. We encourage you to fill out the welcome pad that's in the pew. Also, any prayer requests, we encourage you to do that as well and turn that in during the first hymn. Please rise for the confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, in the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of your sins in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please join me in singing hymn 858. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please join me in the Kyrie. Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God, your bountiful goodness fills all creation. Keep us safe from all that may hurt us, the whole and well in body and spirit. We may with grateful hearts accomplish all that you would have us do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading is from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4. The reading from Deuteronomy. For ask now about former ages, long before your own, ever since the day that God created human beings on earth. Ask from one end of heaven to the other. Has anything so great as this ever happened, or has its like ever been heard of? Has any people ever heard the voice of a God speaking out of a fire as you have heard and lived? To you it was shown so that you would acknowledge that the Lord is God. There is no other besides him. From heaven he made you hear his voice to disciple you. On earth he showed you his great fire while you heard his words coming out of the fire. And because he loved your ancestors, he chose their descendants after them. He brought you out of Egypt with his own presence by his great power, driving out before you nations greater and mightier than yourselves, to bring you in, giving you their land for a possession as it is still today. So acknowledge today and take to heart that the Lord is God in heaven above and on the earth beneath. There is no other. Keep his statutes and his commandments, which I am commanding you today for your own well-being and that of your descendants after you, so that you may long remain in the land that the Lord your God is giving you for all time. The word of the Lord. Please join in a responsive prayer of Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. For he has founded it on the seas. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? Who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully. Such is the company of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. The second reading is from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 3. The reading from 1 Corinthians. What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. That foundation is Jesus Christ. So let no one boast about human leaders, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future. All belong to you, and you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. The word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law, indeed, was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I invite all the kids to come forward this morning. Adults, you can be seated. Go ahead. Good morning, boys.
Good morning, girls.
All right. Okay, let me see. Come on up, everybody. You're going to want to come up today. All right, not that we ever have a dud for a children's sermon, but this one is particularly good, if I don't say so in my own opinion, huh? Would you go ahead and pat me on the back, please? No, never mind. Sorry about that. Come on up, boys. Come on up. Come on up. All right. All right. Now, in a minute, I'm going to send you back to your seats with this, okay? There's one for each of you, all right? So, but before we do that, okay, I don't know where to stand. I'll stand over here, all right? Before we do that, we're gonna play a choosing game, okay? So I'm gonna show you two things. I'm gonna show you one thing, and you choose whether it belongs to me or whether it belongs to God. Okay? Excuse me, I got a little frog in my throat today. So you choose, when I show you something, does it belong to me or does it belong to God? Now, the first thing that I'm going to show you is this Bible, okay? All right? This is one of our third grade Bibles, I think. All right? So, tell me, is this Bible mine or does it belong to God? Which do you think, Carter? Think it belongs to God. Why would that be? Because God's Word is in the Bible, right? You might say that because this is from God, it belongs to God. Now, I might keep it, and we might call it mine, or we might give it to a student. Go ahead, Parker. All right? And then it would belong to the student, but the first person it belonged to is God. He gives it to us. Okay? All right, now these are going to get a little bit harder, all right? But I'm going to keep an easy one going. All right, if you look at this church, look at the building here. Look all around. All right? Pretty beautiful place, isn't it, huh? Does this church belong to God or does it belong to me? This is not a trick question. This one belongs to God, doesn't it, right? The church belongs to God. Of course it does. Of course it does. Okay, now it is going to get harder. All right? All right, this is a picture of my family. Huh? These are my kids when they were little, all right? And this is my wife, Tammy, this is her daughter, Caitlin, and our son, Alex. Now, do my children belong to me or do they belong to God? Which would you say? What do you think, Britt? Why? They belong to God because he looks after them, he makes sure they're okay, and of course, you know, we have to confess, right? We have to admit that, in fact, God made my children, huh? Just like God made each of you. All right. Hadley, would you hold that, please, sweetheart? Okay. All right. Now it's going to get a little bit tougher now, okay? All right. My car is too big to bring into the sanctuary, but these are my car keys, okay? All right. Let me ask you something. Huh? Now, I paid the taxes on my car. Boy, that's expensive, huh? Yeah, but, or more properly, my wife pays the taxes for me on the car. And And our name is on the car, right? But I didn't really make the metal that came out of the ground for my car, and I didn't make the plastic which came from oil in the ground, from petroleum, right? Who made those things? Who made the metal that my car was built out of? Who makes the rocks in the earth? God does. Who makes the metal in the earth? God does, right? So in a way, I'd have to say that God made the things that go into my car, right? So I could also probably say, well, even my car belongs to God, right? Now here's the last one. What do you think? This is my money, all right? Oh boy, I need to go see Tammy again, don't I, huh? I don't have very much in here. Time for ask for my allowance. All right? Let me ask you something. The wealth, the money that we have, the finances that we have, do you think they belong to us or do they belong to God? Who did they come from? I'll lead the witness a little bit, huh? Okay, they came from God. They came from God. Now, he gives it to us, and for a time, he trusts us to use those things wisely. So whether it's my finances, or whether it's my car, my property, or whether it is my family, all of these things belong to God. Whether it's the word that God gives to me, all of these things are God's. He made them, all right? And he gives them to us so that we might use them wisely. Pretty special, isn't it? And he does all of this because of the cross of Jesus, because Jesus loved us so much that he gave his life for us, that he went to the cross and died for us. So God gives us these things, and he says, I want you to use them wisely, and I want you to remember that all good things come from God. Would you fold your hands, please? All right? And in a minute, I'm going to give you something to take as a reminder that because of Jesus' love on the cross, you belong to God too. Okay? So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for making me your daughter or son. Thank you for being with me every day and every place that I go. Help me to see that everything that you have made belongs to you, that I belong to you, and my family belongs to you, and everything belongs to you. Thank you for your great and powerful love. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, now before you're seated, all right, we're going to put this back here. You don't want to take that back. You probably have a picture of your own family, I bet, huh? Please go ahead and take one of the plastic bags. Now in each bag, okay, there is a cross and there's a string. You can make a necklace out of it. Be careful, okay, guys, because little kids can choke on these things, so be careful. Don't let your sister near any of these, okay? All right, don't put them in your mouth. But go ahead and take one, please. All right. And then if you want to trade with your brother or your sister or another, you know, with a sibling, you can do that. So take one for your brother too, maybe, huh? I'm sure there's enough. You think you'll want one? No? All right, I'm telling you. I'm telling you, Brock, you're missing out, man. You're missing out. There's some good beads in here. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, dear friends, in Christ, grace to you and peace from the one who makes us his own and adopts us as children into his heavenly family. Amen. Why is it that when we think about the magnificent things in the world, in the cosmos, in the universe, why is it when we look at a place like this and wonder at its beauty, or when we look at the stars in the heavens above at night, we can't help but confess and witness that all of this is from God, that God is the author of all of these things? Why is it that when we look at something grand and marvelous, that immediately it strikes us, does this belong to me, or is this the work of the Lord? I don't know. But we are quick to confess. We give our testimony that who am I, O Lord, that you would count me worthy of your son Jesus' life? Who Who am I that you have made me in your own image and fashioned me after your own likeness? But we do. And if we can confess that God is the maker of all that is, all that we see, all that we do not see, as we say in the Nicene Creed, if we can confess that God is the author of the great things, then how can we not also confess that God is the author of all that I have, of all that I am, of all that I will say or do that is good and righteous? All things good are from God, and ultimately all things belong to God. This is our confession as Christians. And so we are called, and we aspire, and we strive to be good stewards with that which God has given into our midst. Last week, we talked about trust, and Linda Mayrose did an excellent job talking about how it's no small act of faith to put our trust in God. But if we are to be good stewards, we have to begin there, don't we? You would never give anything back over to the Lord if you didn't trust that there would be enough for the days that are to come. Today, we will be hearing from a good friend of ours, Ms. Nancy Isebrand, talking about what it means to acknowledge that the one in whom we put our trust, the Lord God of heaven and earth, what it means to acknowledge that he is, in fact, the author of all, the giver of every good thing, that he is generous and gracious, more so than we can possibly begin to imagine. And so this morning, Ms. Isebrand, thanks for coming up again. You know, it's no small feat to stand in front of everybody and talk a little bit, huh? And Ms. Isebrand isn't paid to do that kind of thing, at least not in a church setting. But she is a great speaker, and I think you'll be quite blessed with her testimony this morning. So Ms. Isebrand, welcome. Let's welcome Ms. Isebrand this morning for speaking.
So I was a bit overwhelmed when Pastor Chris asked me to speak on acknowledgement, and especially in relation to Psalm 24:1. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell within. I mean, after all, look at all of you. Every one of you has been blessed in each ways. Every one of you has your own story, but I acknowledge that he picked me. When he first picked me, I didn't sleep very well. That first night, running over 1,000 different ideas in my head. I've probably changed my ideas numerous times then as well, but what I really needed to do was pray. I need to acknowledge God and what he means to me. Now, according to the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, because after all, I'm an English teacher and librarian, I have to tie some education into here, acknowledge can mean to take notice or recognize the status of someone or something. It can also mean to recognize as genuine or valid. I acknowledge that God is my loving Father, that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. But what does that mean? To me, it means the way I need to live my life. I'll give you a little background. First of all, I grew up Catholic. Don't hold that against me. But I was very fortunate to grow up with parents who were and still are wonderful examples of what it means to follow Christ. They taught me to trust the Lord in everything. When I was in middle school, they had to auction everything off in the middle of winter, and we didn't have a place lined up for us to live at the time. Yet they gave the situation to the Lord, and he provided. Because of their faith, I never once questioned that everything was going to not turn out. And when an acreage became available and a new job opened up for my dad, they acknowledged God's power and grace in everything. I grew up acknowledging that God is in control. He loves us and he cares for us. Life went on. I went to college, started teaching, met Corey, became Lutheran, got married, had 2 kids. Life was good. God was good. So how do I acknowledge him in my life? One way is by using the talents he gives me. He gave me the talent to teach, so not only do I teach at school, I've spent many years teaching Sunday school. I get to teach kids to acknowledge God's goodness, but I also get to experience it every week. The students' enthusiasm for God's word with their stories, songs, and actions surrounds me with God's fullness. Their hugs and smiles remind me of what is good in the world. I'm also able to acknowledge God with music. As many of you know, I do this with People of Praise, the Bell Choir, and with Sunday School. It is so fun to teach kids to celebrate God and his many gifts to us. There we shout and we sing and we dance to acknowledge God. But what happens when life gets tough? Or when life gets way too busy? In June of 2016, our daughter was in a horrific car accident. I can still remember getting the phone call. We had no details other than the girls were being transported to St. Luke's. God stepped in at that moment to remind me to acknowledge him in all things. Corey and I prayed all the way to Sioux City. We didn't pray that all was well, though we were wishing it. Instead, we prayed that we were putting Amy into God's hands and help us to trust him in everything. That was probably the hardest thing I had to do at that point in my life. Tears were streaming down my face as I prayed, but we gave her to God. We knew we had to acknowledge him no matter what happened. We had a positive outcome. In fact, right now she is participating in the Chicago Marathon as a fundraiser for the University of Iowa Children's Hospital. Please pray that she finishes. Positive outcomes don't always happen, though, and that's even when it's harder to acknowledge God. 2 years ago, my dad was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. He was in the early stages yet, and they sold the acreage, moved to Ankeny to be closer to more available health care. Things went smoothly. Dad and Mom soon threw themselves into city life, and they are fully engaged in their new church and community. Dad would repeat a few stories once in a while, but all was going well. There's slight decline in his memory, but nothing major that we could notice. 2 weeks ago, we were visiting. Dad repeated the same question 3 times in 2 minutes, the exact same phrases. He had no idea that I already answered him. My aunt visited the next weekend. She noticed that after some good conversation, it was like he left the room. He didn't seem to see her. He didn't converse anymore. He had a very difficult time participating in the conversation in our family gathering last Saturday. This is the same guy that knows someone everywhere he goes. He is always able to strike up a conversation, and now he doesn't recognize people. I know many of you have gone through something similar with your loved ones. It's not fair. This is the guy that has trusted God with everything, which has been a strong witness for God's love and power. But you know what? Life isn't fair. God is still good, though. Dad may not know people anymore. He might not always be able to keep a conversation going, and he's starting to decline more rapidly than we had hoped for, but he still trusts God. He is a devout follower of the Lord, and he spends hours each day praying for so many people. I know he's praying for me right now. He still trusts that the Lord will take care of him and of Mom. Mom's the same way. Both of them continue to put each day into God's hands. They truly live 1 Peter 5, verse 7. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you. And that's what I have to do each day, especially among the chaos and the noise. As I tell my Sunday school students, trusting and believing in God does not mean that life will be easy. Instead, he promises to be right beside us, holding our hands and walking us through each trial. Those are the times I need to acknowledge God the most. It may be through song, it may be through prayer, it may be through silence, it may be through reading the word. But by acknowledging his power and love, I can let him carry me through and truly see he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. As we heard in the first reading from Deuteronomy, so acknowledge today and take to heart that the Lord is God in heaven. The Lord is God in heaven above and on earth beneath. There is no other. When I rejoice in the Lord, darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice. No matter my situation, I am truly able to acknowledge how great is our God. Thank you.
Let's express our appreciation and thanks for Ms. Isebrand. And then one of the highest ways to praise and acknowledge the Lord is to join our voices in singing. Let us rise and sing verses 1, 4, and 5 of that great hymn, 855.
Please join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Lord of mercy, we cry to you for help, trusting in your compassion for your whole creation. Raise up the baptized to offer Christ healing and forgiveness to all in distress. Lord, in your mercy, we seek the kingdom that cannot be shaken. Come to the rescue of those who are displaced by war, famine, and other disaster. Provide deliverance and justice to all who are depressed. Lord, in your mercy, you know our needs in the community. Heal the hurts of all, sickness, aging, suffering, especially Sandy, Moni, Tara, Dylan, Vern, Diane, Robin, Marlis, Walker, Alex, Cade, Mel, and all those we name in the silence of our heart at this time. Accompany those who visit the homebound members, the hospitalized, and those who are in prison. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and more we ask in the name of our risen Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please share in God's peace.
With thanks and praise, let us offer our gifts to the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love through the one who gave himself to us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to our Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join in this unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to all, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you, for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Come, all now is ready. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Please rise for prayer. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your freedom, love in the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me in the last hymn.
Please be seated for just a moment for the announcements. This beautiful window is one of many at St. John's, of course. It is out in the narthex or the lobby on the west wall. And if you are ever through church in the evening, be sure to look at it as the sun shines through. One of the great windows, the three wise men, acknowledging that Christ is King of Kings. If you're visiting today, welcome. Please grab and take home one of the gift bags. After all, there's lots of good stuff in there. All right, rifle through that. There's all kinds of neat things. And thank you for visiting this morning. Last night, it was our great privilege and joy to baptize little Iverson Josephine Anthony. What a pretty girl and a beautiful name. And congratulations to Braden Anthony and Haley, huh? Haley, Kaylee. Oh, well, I'll get it right next service. How about that, huh? Next week, we hope you join us again as we continue our talk on stewardship. We'll go from trust to acknowledgement to willingness and to putting our faith into action. And speaking of willingness, next week is going to be Mr. Dave Grossenheider. He's going to talk a little bit about his journey and in particular the path that led him to bring Spirit 712 to you here. And so we look forward to welcoming Mr. Grossenheider next week. We are also looking for the high school and adult brass players to come together for a Reformation Festival Sunday special. It's going to be spectacular. And if you know how to play any brass instrument, we hope that you'll talk to Mike after the service. Am I getting this right, guys, up there? Is that right? All right, 10-4. Sounds good. And then on the 17th at the late service, we're hoping to gather a band and an orchestra of all the middle school, junior high kids. So look for that at the late service at 10:45, and encourage any middle school kid that you know of, if they play an instrument of any variety, to talk to Mike and get signed up for that. It's going to be really kind of a special time. You know, we had that little white stuff in the air this last weekend, and if you've ever wondered, will church be canceled because of snow? The answer is no. I don't ever cancel church because of snow. But if you want to find out more, Clem Radio is a great way to do it, but the Textcaster function is an easier way because it comes to you instantaneously. You can see us in the church office for more info about that, but it's an easy way to keep in touch. Speaking of snow, talk about an act of faith. We're selling the snowblower, so if you want it, come see Kim in the church office. And with that, please rise for the benediction.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.